It's a 1 minute early to the starting time, but we have a very ambitious program today, so I want to get started. On behalf of the AI Engineering Study Group, I would like to welcome you to this 2014 study group session. And as for the first part of introduction, I want to just explain. So I'm the chair for this year, but after this session, I will be the past chair. And for the next year, it's going to be Christoph, Fraser, and then Steve Lang. So that's how this governance committee will work, which is in accordance with the ISMRF. So as most of you know, we had a very sad news this year. That was Dr. Bill Edelstein, who is one of the pioneers in the MRI hardware engineering. He passed away. And when this news hit us, of course, this engineering society was very sad to hear this. But as the head of this year's study group, I felt that we have to organize a special tribute to celebrate Bill's contribution to all of us, to the society, and also for all of us, because many of us here had some interactions with him, projects, and he was a definitely charismatic character, individual, so that was, we will miss Bill. And another thing is that since we have a new younger members joining us to this society, it's important for them to know what the contributions Bill has made for all of us. So because of those purposes, we invited four actually distinguished speakers who have worked with Bill very closely. And I also had an exchange with Dr. Cecil Hayes, who is the inventor of birdcage coil. And he was, I miss Bill on almost a daily basis. We have known each other for about 46 years. Bill was 1 year behind me at Harvard, where we both had a Professor Pang as our thesis advisor. My thesis used NMR, but Bill's was on angular correlations of gamma rays from a decaying mercury isotope. We used to talk occasionally on Skype for 1 hour or two at a time. And he misses, of course, Bill. So without any further ado, I would like to introduce Professor Green Johnson from University of East Anglia, UK. And speakers, please get ready, because we have some very tight program here. So I would like the next speaker to have a computer ready and come here and get started.
Yes.
Give us 45 seconds.
There's more seats here in the front.
And while he is preparing his presentation, first session is these four talks, yes? And after the four talks were completed, what's going to happen is that we have an oral session here for the posters selected from this year's abstract, and also poster presentations in the different room, number
six and seven.
So for those who are going to present posters, please go to those rooms, and Fraser and Christoph will manage the session. And then at the end of the session, best three posters will be chosen. And we will give a certificate and some prizes. Okay. Also, we have made a special poster for Bill, so please make sure to get one for yourself.
Yeah. So I'm going to present a few recollections that I drew together from myself. I was a doctoral student in Aberdeen for all of the time that Bill was there as a postdoc. I also consulted Tom Redpath, who was another doctoral student at that time, and Jim Hutchison, who was the head of the NMR imaging group. Of course, Bill didn't actually, he existed before Aberdeen. These are a few photographs that his daughter, Jean Edelstein, provided me with. The one on the top left is him, the first time he met his father, who was an officer in the US Air Force in Burma during the war, and it was a year before he actually met Bill for the first time. That's Bill's high school photo, looking very enthusiastic as usual. PhD group that he was in Harvard, and also, have you got a pointer? And that was Bill on his wedding day in Glasgow in 1977. And it was immediately after that that he moved to Aberdeen. He was in Glasgow searching for gravity waves, which is a fairly sort of futile exercise, or at least it was there. So for some reason he decided to embark on another futile exercise, which was to get images out of magnetic resonance. John Mallard, who was the head of the medical physics department in Aberdeen, had managed to get a princely £30,000 out of the Medical Research Council to build a whole body NMR imaging machine. And according to the internet, that's even at current prices, that's only £150,000. So it's really very little money indeed. That paid for a magnet essentially, and it paid for 3 years of Bill's time. This is. Right. This is Jim Hutchison, that's John Mallard. I have no idea who that is, actually, if anyone knows. He's around the time, I don't know. That's Meg Hutchison, who's also a fairly distinguished NMR researcher in her own right, and Jim's wife. Why she's half out of the photograph, I'm not quite sure. Actually, if you know Meg, you'll know that getting order in the photograph may be quite difficult. I noticed that the plenary talk was about magnet technology. I missed it, unfortunately, but one of the topics is where we came from. This is actually where we came from. This is the first whole-body magnet that Oxford Instruments made. As you can see, it's a vertical bore magnet. The reason for that was that Jim was a bit worried about building an RF coil using saddle cord because the filling factor would be terrible. So he thought it would be better to use a vertical coil, a vertical field magnet, so he could build a solenoidal coil, which would give better performance. Of course, the downside is that you can't really create very big fields, magnetic fields with that, and this one indeed was 0.04 Tesla. Air cord, as I say, vertical. This was a horrible magnet. It was just terrible. 200 parts per million at a 20 centimetre radius homogeneity. Admittedly, when you've got a really low field, that's only over 3 hertz. But it was a very bad homogeneity. And the worst thing was that the operating temperature was approximately 100 degrees centigrade. Now, there was a bit of an argument between Oxford Instruments and Jim about whose fault that was, whether the specification was sufficiently tight, or whether Oxford Instruments really ought to have known that if you're trying to image people, you can't create a temperatures like that. The other thing about this is it shorted out on at least two occasions between the turns around here and the aluminium bobbins. So this was the magnet as it arrived, again Jim next to it. So the first task that Jim and Bill had was to somehow retrofit cooling to it. This is the result, it's sort of Heath Robinson-ish affair. One of the problems with this is that you might think, well, just run water over it. But aluminium is slightly porous, so if you do that, then you short out the magnet. So what they had to do was to lacquer the bobbins of the magnet and then bolt aluminium, grooved aluminium plates onto the surface of the magnet, plumb them in with. You just see these copper, turns of copper pipe and pump water through it. And when you did that, indeed, you got a machine. It was still pretty warm in there, but it did run at a feasible temperature. The second difficulty, well, there are lots of difficulties, obviously. If you're building an AMR machine from scratch, there are lots of difficulties. But one of them was that the power supply, you had to convert AC and doors to DC to run this magnet. And what they originally used was a motor generator. It wasn't this one, but it was something rather similar to it. These are hideous devices. They're, you know, a couple of meters long, a meter high. And eventually they decided to replace that with a nice, spiffy Hewlett-Packard power supply. This was run from the three-phase supply, and this is proper Scottish three-phase, 415 volts, not of your American wimpy stuff. It was a good voltage. But Jim and Bill thought, you know, before they actually spent the money on this power supply, that they really ought to test if the voltage was what they claimed to be. Jim carefully disabled all the interlocks on this, not this one, but a switching box similar to this, opened it up, and very carefully approached it with his multimeter. Now, this is obviously something you don't do lightly, but in principle it's perfectly safe, because there's a you know, huge, great resistor in series with your probes. There is, that is, if it's switched to voltage mode. If it's in current mode, there was an enormous bang. And I don't think, you know, anyone, even people who love Bill and Jim, would describe them as athletic. But God, they moved fast. They leapt backwards about 6 feet. The probes of this multimeter were melted. You know, the inside was completely vaporised. It was spectacular, I'll tell you that. They didn't try it again. But luckily, no one was hurt. The next problem they had was shielding, and this is actually, I think, my greatest contribution to science was actually helping build this shield. None of the difficult bits, well, it wasn't difficult, but none of the complicated bits. But Bill and Jim originally thought that they wouldn't need shielding, but it became rapidly obvious that yes, they did. There was all sorts of RF interference. And of course, we had no money. So the way that a big company would do it, or a properly funded research group would do it, would probably be with big copper plates, which you'd bolt onto a frame and solder together. Copper's very expensive. Aluminium is a lot cheaper. So what they did was they got a local carpenter called Willie Hutchinson, no relation to Jim, to build this wooden frame that you see here. And Bill calculated on, you know, best electromagnetic principles that provided you actually join these aluminium sheets at about 1 centimetre or 2 centimetre intervals, this would do an adequate job of shielding. That was Bill's genius in a way, I think, finding sort of neat practical solutions, maybe not the most elegant, but solutions that work to engineering problems. He wrote an article which he described his time in Aberdeen that was subtitled Good Enough Engineering, which I think is actually to underestimate how clever some of these things were. This wasn't a brilliant solution, but it worked, that's the point. But what you had to do was, you know, soldering aluminium or soldering aluminium for half the audience is not easy to do, but you can get aluminium solder. But to make sure that the connections are pretty solid, what I had to do, was put a copper nail in at 1 centimetre intervals all the way around these sheets of aluminium, nailing it to this wooden frame. And Bill followed me with the solder, which smelled foul. I have no idea what was in it, but the flux was just vile. And so we're in that tiny room, you can't really see it, but the outside of it, but, you know, choking on these fumes and my fingers bleeding. Nevertheless, it worked. That was the point. In the end, it worked. About this time, I'm not sure that we probably won't get the sound for this. About this time, Bill became obsessed with this TV program called The Great Egg Race. I just want to play, if it plays, I'll play a short clip of this. You can just about. Of its time, shall we say. those of you who know Jim know that he's paralytically shy, basically, so he wasn't going to volunteer for any TV programme. I'm not much better, and certainly wasn't then. But Jim, Bill could not be denied. We had to form a team. So we did. We went down to Salford in Greater Manchester, and we were given the task of building a set of scales to measure the weight of a human being to within 5%. And, of course, you know, all being, you know, PhDs or potential PhDs versus, you know, more engineering people, we came last. Bill was quite upset for about 5 minutes, and then he concluded that this was really a sprint. This wasn't serious science. That, you know, we weren't any good at this sort of stuff, but we were good at the big stuff. We were good at the marathons. And the marathon, in this case, was trying to find out how to form a decent image. And it was now post-case space. I think everything, imaging methods, seemed fairly obvious. But this was before anyone had formulated any formal sort of idea of case space. And there was really no idea, no consensus about how a good image could be formed. No one had produced a really good image yet. And there were multiple different methods. There's phonar, Remington-Edwards phonar. There's this thing called rotating frame zoomatography, which involved, as I recall, a static magnetic field, which you actually changed the configuration of during the imaging process. Fourier zoomatography, there were various sensitive point and sensitive line methods. As I said, really, there was no clear idea of how we should form images. In Aberdeen, because we had this lousy magnet, Jim had been concentrating on a line scanning method, because if you tried to do something which looked had theoretical signals, noise advantages like projection reconstruction, with a lousy magnet like that, your images were smeared everywhere. You can't really get anything out of it. Line scanning was somewhat easier, and he got a method to work, but as you can see, it does suffer from problems. This was a subtractive method, so if you've got any movement at all, as through the heart here, you try and subtract two different signals and you get nonsense, and indeed, that's what you've got. Tom Redpath, at about this time, was interested in, as we all were, in what a good method would be. And he found this paper by Peter Mansfield called Echoplanar Imaging, about something called echoplanar imaging. And he really had no idea of how it worked. There's a preamble that I think spin warp imaging, it occurred because of a fortuitous combination of Bill's great ingenuity, our absolutely crappy equipment, and the stupidity of graduate students who couldn't understand papers and therefore asked Bill. So Tom asked Bill about this echoplanar imaging. And I just want to read something from this paper, because you probably haven't, even those of us who remember it at the time probably haven't seen it for a long time. The caption to this image on the right is spin projections for a homogeneous annulus. The upper projection dotted is the projection in GY alone. This turns into the discrete profile if GY is modulated. The lower projection corresponds to the application of a modulated GY gradient together with GZ on continuously. Now, even knowing how EPI works with the benefit of hindsight, I can't understand what that means. And Tom couldn't either. So he went to Bill, and Bill came back, as I recall, about 2 days later. He didn't spend very long on this. And he said, well, I understand what he's trying to do. It won't work because the signal is reverse and alternate echoes, which Mansfield didn't measure. And this is no knock on Mansfield. Mansfield's a brilliant man. And to actually see that this method had any hope of working at all without fully understanding it, I think he's close to genius. But yeah, Bill came back and said, it won't work because of this reversal problem. This continuous gradient isn't a good idea. It'd be much better to blip it. But even then, it's not going to work very well because your signal is decaying with T2 star. You just won't have enough time to form a good image. But what you can do is instead of trying to collect all the echoes at once, you can collect a limited number of echoes and proceed it with a compensatory GZ, in this case gradient. And so you can collect only, you know, 8 echoes, or 4 echoes, or 2 echoes, or 1 echo. And that compensatory gradient has to increase in size before that in order to compensate for the blips you're missing. And that's how Spinwarp came about. It wasn't, Bill at that point was unfamiliar with the Fourier technique of Ernst. It was through interpreting echo planar imaging that came about. And this is Bill again, characteristically sartorial. And one of the first spin warp images. This, again, it's hard for you youngsters to understand this, but computers were incredibly rare then. The department had one, this PDP-11, which was the other side of the building. So in order to get any images, you had to trail wires through the building late at night, because otherwise people would be tripping over them and pulling them out, connect them to your ADC, and so all the experiments had to be done at night. And I wasn't there, unfortunately, being a lazy graduate student, but I came in one morning and Bill came up to me and said, do you want to see an image? And he showed me these. Now, these may not look great to you, but God, they were good. I'll show some comparisons. There is really pretty, you can see stuff. You can see the heart, you can see the liver and the spleen. This is a bit unfair because these two images were taken 2 years earlier. But one is a phonar image from Ray Damadian, and if you actually knew how this was acquired, you'd be even less impressed with it. This is a rather optimistic interpretation from Mansfield's group of an abdominal image. This apparently is the liver, there's a kidney. I don't know how that bit of blackness is a kidney as opposed to that bit of blackness, but that's what it is. So that was it. That was the origins of Spin Warp. Bill could appear quite abrasive, I think it has to be said. I don't think he was. I think he was an extremely kind man. He certainly was very, very tolerant of stupid graduate students like myself. He spent an awful lot of time telling me how to do things and how things worked. Tom Redpath would concur. He was very helpful, but he didn't like bosses very much, and he rubbed John Mallard up really the wrong way. And after 3 years, Mallard decided he'd had enough of it, basically, and made no great efforts to retain him, even though Bill wanted to remain in the team. And so he left, and our loss was G's gain. Bill always said his proudest achievement in Aberdeen was Arthur, which is, this is just before they left, in front of the house they lived in Aberdeen. And ever afterwards, when I ran into him in conferences, I suspect this was the case with other colleagues as well, he'd come up to you, he was a keen photographer, he'd say, do you want to see a great image? Yeah, sure. And he produced images of photographs of his family. He was a good man, and it's a pity he's gone.
end of the session, if you feel like it, please come to the front to autograph a poster, because this poster will go to Bill's family. So if you have a time, please do so. Thank you.
So, well, that's a sad time. And I'd just like to say that, actually, before I start, Bill's family asked me to convey their deep appreciation for how he was being remembered by the society at this SMRM meeting. Anyway, in the end, I guess, everyone gets their own set of start and end dates, and it's connected by this dash in the middle. But actually, the dash represents your whole life. And Bill's dash was rather large. So his impact on the field of magnetic resonance in medicine was really immense and really fundamental to what we have today in MRI. Bill had been dealing with cancer for the last couple of years, but he was very vigorous. So he was working up really right up to the last minute on a project to make quiet MRI. So when it happened, when he died suddenly at home, the news still came as somewhat of a shock. In my mind, to understand Bill's impact on MRI, it's really important to recognize how far we came. This mid-1970s paper by Paul Lauterbach basically represented the state of the art of the field of MRI at the time. This really was how it was, and my previous speaker showed another sequence which no one could figure out either. But you take a look at this sequence and you say, well, does anyone recognize it? Can you see what it is? Can you see what the hell is going on here? Well, compared with a modern sequence, I pretty much doubt it. Maybe if you look carefully, a few bells will go off. Well, the first thing you'll see that there's some projection gradients, which you can see there in amber, in orange there. Okay, so there's your projections. Now you'll see a square RF pulse, and it's in the presence of a gradient pulse. Oh, okay, that must be selective excitation. But it's not like any selective excitation anyone uses or sees today. There's no RF modulation. There's no refocusing lobe on the gradient. The slices are moved, actually, if you go to the very top of that timing diagram, the slices are moved not by changing the NMR frequency, but by changing the main magnetic field strength. So, taking a look at this, you can see that it's missing almost everything, or most of the key ingredients that make MRI really work. So, it's not surprising that when you try sequences like this, you get kind of messy looking images. As you heard from the previous speaker, Bill Edelstein went to Aberdeen as a postdoctoral fellow in 1977 to make a whole body MRI scan. They got some first images in 1980 using a 2D line scan selective excitation method, but there were obviously major problems. You know, the image on the right, which is a brain, would be great if it were a tube or something, but this isn't actually a brain and you can't really see much in there. And the heart, well, the heart is sort of, on the left image, is kind of distributed all over the place. So, as we heard, it was Bill's idea to replace the line scan selective excitation with a blipped gradient, with actually really quite important contributions, I think, from Jim Hutchison. The result published in 1980 was the spin-walk method. So, this is the transition. So here, really, for the first time, we see in one place all of the key ingredients of a modern MRI pulse sequence. We have amplitude-modulated RF pulses. Well, there's something new there. We have a negative refocusing lobe on the slice selection. We also have negative lobes on the readout gradient to produce a gradient that's a gradient refocused echo. So if you don't do that, as soon as you turn on the gradient, as soon as you turn on the gradient, you can't record anything because the gradient is turning on, so you miss the first few points on the of the projection, and your image is just convoluted with horrible artifacts. So then, of course, we have the famous spin warp phase encoding gradients. So actually, when you do a literature search on this, you see this paper was only cited 600 times, only 600 times, and you think, well, you know, this thing about citations is not really worth as much as you may think. There are 20 or 30,000 MRI scanners in the world today, and every one of them has this pulse sequence in it, the spin warp pulse sequence. So here is an example where it's just so common that you don't even bother referring to it, but it is fundamental to the technology. The 400 Gauss scanner, you saw that earlier at Aberdeen, it really did produce by far the most impressive images of the time, acquired in just a few minutes. So Bill's fellowship at Aberdeen ended in 1980, and we heard that Mallard, we heard the interesting story about that from the previous speaker. So at that time, after 1980, Bill, and actually I was in the same boat, we're looking for jobs, you know, we're just like everybody else, we need a job. So Bill got recruited to GE in upstate New York in September 1980. The project that we were recruited to work on was to build a whole body system for performing spectroscopy to measure metabolism in the body, not MRI. GE was not interested in MRI in 1980 because they felt it couldn't compete with their X-ray CT product, because the signal-to-noise of a pin in a vacuum for an X-ray system was far, far greater than anything that NMR could do on a real person. Anyway, to do MRS spectroscopy, a superconducting magnet with the highest possible field strength was ordered from Oxford Instruments. This turned out to be 1.5 Tesla, and that's where Bill and I first met as GE newbies, arriving really within a month of each other. So we get there, and Bill and I wanted to do MRI. We had this discussion, it was actually a short discussion. I want to do MRI. I want to do MRI too. And we were actually really quite surprised that MRI was written off by GE. But to keep us out of trouble, well, I guess we came with bits of reputations, but to keep us out of trouble, while we waited for the 1.5T magnet, GE agreed that we would build a 1200 Gauss MRI system based on a body size resistive magnet. They figured that the MRI technology, I guess, that we would develop by building this system would have some later value for the spectroscopy project, where localization would be required. So Bill and I and the other collaborators in the group started building an MRI system. Here's Bill. He's making a body coil there. You can see it's a saddle coil. And that's actually, that's a great picture because that was one of our managers stuck in that tube. Kept him there for as long as we could. Here's another one of Bill sealing the screened room with a blowtorch. So Bill and I acquired the first images on the 1200 Gauss scanner in September 1981. That's Bill in the scanner. And that system was packaged and shipped. It was the first scanner that came out of GE. It was shipped to the Hospital of the University of Pennsylvania. So we put it in a box and make it look pretty. And Bill played a key role in getting that working in Philadelphia, and which really put put the Philadelphia group on the map for MRI. We had got the first GE systems from this system in 1981, September, with using projection reconstruction. And as you can see, top left, they were really bad. We needed images to show that we got, both Bill and I got invitations to present at the Winston-Salem meeting, which was about a week later. And we needed something. We had to have something to show at the conference, so we needed some emergency images. So we switched to the spin warp MRI method, and the images got much better. And we took those images to the meeting, and we stuck with spin warp. But the method that we used, or the spin warp method we were using, still needed a few tweaks that most people may not know about. The tweaks were, at the height, when Johnson spoke about the lousy magnet he had from Oxford and worked at 400 Gauss, but that corresponded, the inhomogeneity corresponded to a few hertz. Well, we had a pretty crappy magnet as well, and our magnet was so bad that, compared to the Aberdeen, the magnet was much less uniform in absolute hertz, causing really major T2 star problems. And of course, to overcome the T2 star problems, we had to use spin echoes. So, you get the same problem there. As soon as you turn the 180 degree on, as soon as you put a gradient on, you get a signal. And the signal happens right during the transition point of the gradient, so you lose all the first points and you get these horrendous artifacts. So it doesn't solve the T2, an echo per se does not solve the T2 star problem. Bill and I came up with the fix of adding the balancing lobes to the gradient to move the echo to its to the proper location where echoes are supposed to be at the echo time, to twice the distance between the 90 and 180 degree pulse. So that went in there, and Bill presented the images using this method at the North Carolina meeting in October 1981. The meeting was attended by all the MRI pioneers, and here you can see Bill, Edelstein, Paul Lauterbach, Peter Mansfield, and David Holt, who I would say were the people that came up with the three methods of localization that we use today: projections, slice selections, and spin wall phasing codes. So Bill had a habit of coming up with solutions and new insights just when needed. In 1983, being puzzled by the poor T1 and T2 contrast in the images from our 1200 Gauss scanner, Bill introduced the concept of the contrast-to-noise ratio. He calculated it for a whole slew of different MRI sequences. Interestingly, it was the appendix of that paper that kind of got us into trouble later, not in a negative sense, but the appendix of the paper includes a version of the flash MRI, the pulse sequence, which got us into a patent dispute with Max Planck. That paper has been cited 200 or so times. There were a number of other inventions with Bill around 1982 that had been absorbed into the fabric of modern MRI. Slab selective MRI, for example. Spin echo MRI for T2 imaging and spatial encoding. A lot of these we just patented and never put in the in papers. But they're in there, they're in the scan. Spin echo MRI for T2 imaging, crusher gradients. You all know about crushers, so there's crushers. There they are, wham, wham. You can see them each side of the 180. Also, interesting slice selective chemical shift imaging. We worked on that, where you select a slab and then encode, because if you don't do that, you'll never get your CSI scan done in time. So, anyway, the 1.5T MRI project also started in 1982, and as I discussed in Melbourne, this project evolved from the 1.5T whole body spectroscopy project. Here's the original GE 1.5T team with a few of the innovations that came out of the program, this gradients and coils and so on. You can actually see there, and I should have labeled them, Bill Edelstein, John Skank, and Red Reddington.
It's our manager.
Oh, okay. Let's see what happened here. Let's have a crash now. That's a good time for a crash. Okay, that should be all right. So when GE decided to do MRI in 1982, a whole lot of managers descended on us, I guess they were from the NASA space program, to create charts on how to build a 1.5T MRI scanner. So Bill and I, but it turned out that the big mistake was that Bill and I were actually the only ones who knew how to build a 1.5, who knew how to build a scanner. So actually it's true that Bill didn't like managers, and I guess we didn't like managers, and so we hated the chart and basically refused to comply with any of this. So after about a month went by, and eventually our manager, Red Reddington, got annoyed and he left. Not quite. But all the managers were actually got thrown out. And we got to work, and as you can see on this chart, who was responsible for what. And so I was actually doing the RF and the spectrometer. John Skink was doing the gradients, and Bill was doing the gradient amps. So a major result of having John Skink and Bill Edelstein working together on the gradients was the thumbprint gradient coils. These provided uniform gradients essentially everywhere inside the RF coil. You could use the whole bore of the magnet to do MRI, which you couldn't do up until that point. Nobody remembers that. So these gradients actually went straight into GE's 1.5T commercial product. And that's the next speaker up there. Because of the weird distribution of the optimized conductor locations, they were never wound with wire. The coils were printed directly from the current patterns on copper sheets and wrapped on fiberglass tubes. So that's one of the first gradient tubes. To make coils that worked at 1.5T, we started distributing the tuning capacitance. And I started with this one on the left there. And Bill made distributed capacitance surface coils with diode traps to decouple them. Ultimately, he made this coil. Originally, this was a ladder coil that just ended, open circuit, didn't go all the way around. And it sat on his desk, and then my desk, and his desk again for periods of months while we tried to figure out how to end the coil, because we didn't want to put a 50 ohm load on the resistor, which would degrade it. So suddenly, one day, Bill rushes into my office and says, I have the answer. He'd just spoken to Cecil Hayes in Milwaukee, and apparently he said, we have to connect the coil to itself, continue the thing. So that was done, and the birdcage MRI coil was born. And that's actually the original one, and you can tell it's the original because it's crappy paper capacitors are used. We didn't go with the full expensive ceramic capacitors on it. Anyway, but that paper's actually only been cited 440 times. And you think, oh, gee, that's not much compared to many papers. 440 hits. Okay. Well, again, there isn't a 1.5T or 3T scanner in existence that doesn't have a birdcage coil. So that's a different kind of impact factor, I think. Let's see. Okay, frozen here. Let's have a freeze now. Okay, so GE announced 1.5T head images in November 1982 at the RSNA meeting, and critics in other companies then said that we could do heads, but we couldn't do bodies. So Bill just knuckled down and built a 1.5T body coil. So then we had both head and body coils for the 1983 ILS MRM meeting. The head images and spectra were published in mid-1983 in the Lancet, and we went to the ISMRM meeting in San Francisco with 1.5T results. This turned into a very contentious session with lots of arguments and strong opinions. The underlying factor really was that all the other manufacturers had committed to much lower fields, 0.35 tesla or less. In addition, a number of luminaries in the field had staked out positions in print that MRI was not possible or practical at higher fields. There were three major concerns that drove this. The first was RF penetration. The second was that RF coils couldn't work above 10 megahertz. And the third was that the SNR declined rapidly above field strengths of 0.35 tesla. So there were very heated arguments, and some months later, GE gave out some tongue-in-cheek awards. I got the Scrapper Award. Bill got the Touche Award for his famous quip, paraphrasing a pop song, if you can't have the field you love, love the field you have. So Bill took the attitude anyway that the science would speak for itself and the doubters would ultimately be forced to eat their words. For me, these were very stressful times, and it often seemed like we were battling on all fronts, both inside and outside of GE. The upshot of that was that he and I really forged a comrades-at-arms type bond that really has endured right to the end. You can get a flavour of it from some of these doodles on our whiteboard from the time. There's the blameometer on the left, and then the figure of us protecting protecting MRI at GE on the right. So if Bill was less stressed than me, I think it was because he had a backup career plan that involved opera. Here he is as a gondolier in the Barber of Seville in Schenectady. One great outcome of all the published arguments against Highfield and 1.5T was that it made it rather easy to patent it. After the 83 meeting and a rematch in 84, we then came under increasing pressure from GE to show that the field we were at, 1.5 Tesla, was actually the optimum field strength. For MRI, which would have made the set for, sorry, the field strength. So Bill was then charged with measuring the MRI signal-to-noise ratio at different field strengths. A central problem was that you couldn't really measure the signal-to-noise ratio at different field strengths unless you accounted for differences in the detector performance at each field strength. So he came up with the intrinsic signal-to-noise ratio and how to make quantitative signal-to-noise ratio measurements for comparing field dependence and scanner performance. So the results demonstrated that the best-case field dependence was with magnetic field strength was linear, which confirmed sort of earlier results, and that's where it came from. That's basically the best you can do. The NMR phased array, another enormous advance that will be covered by the next speaker, Pete Romer, in front. There's a picture of the GE gold medals winners. Bill moved to Hopkins in 2007. There he is on the left. He was a distinguished visiting professor in our division. He worked with graduate engineering students and started a small company to make quiet gradients with Dr. Al-Sharkawi, who's pictured there at the right at our annual retreat. Here he is last December with the other Johns Hopkins ISMRM gold medalists, and I'm really proud of that, by the way. And Bill is survived by his wife Fiona, 3 children and 2 grandchildren. He was the best man at my wedding. But I will remember him most as the best man to stand with in those stormy times of the development of high-field MRI. But as long as the spin-warp gradients keep living and his other contributions to the MRI technology live on, I doubt he'll be forgotten. So in that sense, Bill's dash is not yet ended. I had a lot of great quotations and tributes to Bill after his death, but I think this one from Ergun Atalar in Turkey captures the spirit to the end. "You must take living so seriously that even at 70, for example, you'll plant olive trees, and not for your children either, but because although you fear death, you don't really believe it, because living is heavier." Thank you.
Thank you very much for that wonderful tribute. The next speaker is Dr. Pete Romer from GE.
Because I entered the scene after this big bang. I entered the scene after this big bang in MRI at GE's corporate R&D center. I joined the R&D center actually as a nuclear engineer. Happened to be a graduate student at MIT when Three Mile Island hit with the teaching the system as a reactor safety course, and my career fundamentally changed. Joined some friends at the GE Corporate R&D Center in the Electrical Energy Conversion Branch, power systems, rotating machinery, motors, things of that sort. And during that period of time, there were multiple efforts going on in MRI. And there was this sort of outside group working on a permanent magnet system. Clearly, you can see from the work that was going on there, not known to me at the time, I really wasn't in the mainstream. But with that, I did look over the shoulder of a couple of folks and started getting involved in a permanent magnet MRI system. Let me see, what I'll try to discuss today, a little different than the other folks, is I want to show Bill's impact on me and should give you a snapshot of the 10 years overlap that I had with him, and try to tie it together with some of the other stuff you've seen. Here's actually a nice photograph of Bill and Fiona. What you find out is there's not a lot of photographs of Bill because Bill was always taking the photographs. So let's just look at some of the numbers. Chuck was kind to send me a latest copy of Bill's resume, and I was just impressed by the numbers. I mean, it's a 22-page resume, 68 peer-reviewed journal articles, 15 book chapters, right? You can read the numbers. But one of the things that really stood out is, and I'll tie this back to me personally, there's 12 PhD MS students that were mentored or supervised. And these weren't done while at Hopkins. These were done while he was a scientist at a corporate R&D lab. It was not in your job description to do this. It's pretty amazing that he did this over the years consistently. And I think this, you know, ties back to some of the other things about how Bill really cared, and he really saw things, you know, in others that he could help, and in a way, maybe that's a way he could amplify his own impact by helping others. And that's what he did for me. One of the things I tried to do is during the tenure, I saw a person who had a core effort in NMR with around that a tremendous amount of work, and you'll see this in a minute, in all of these areas, whether it's some imaging methods, you know, you got involved preamps, RF calls, RF transmitters, safety aspects, gradient calls. But then from there, he jumped into non-medical applications, using work in gradient coils, imaging methods. He was comfortable living in the world of RF, and there's an RF ground connection. The oil core imaging, his buddy at Shell Oil, Harold Vinegar, also had ideas where there were of removing oil from shale by heating it, and connected that to other problems both Shell and GE had, Superfund sites, which PCBs and other materials that would be remediated. So he also got involved in things like RF ground heating. So I mean, just think of the impact that he had on NMR. And then on top of that, he was doing these other things. This is a group, I thought this was a fun picture. I mean, I had a beard, no, actually, in this one I had just the mustache. Paul has the beard, Chuck doesn't over on the right, but he has it now. And Chris Hardy's in here. You see Bill near there. Bill's got his beard there in the middle. So this was about 1990. So the earlier picture you saw was the team that created the original 1.5T. This you call sort of the intermediate, sustaining team, if you wish, or the next phase of development, in which I had the pleasure to participate in. And I said, so my connection to this was that I was working in this group, permanent magnet system. Hey, we got the shimming right. I didn't realize it at the time, but you know, that was an outside group. Really wasn't the main interest by the MR group. And so they said, okay, you got the magnet shimmed, but now it's too small. You're going to have eddy currents. So I said, okay, well, what's the eddy current spec? They said, well, 1%. Well, I didn't know what the right spec was. Of course, they were getting gradient coils that had 20% eddy currents. They didn't tell me that. So I said, oh, okay, here's how you do it. I had worked in rotating machinery, superconducting generators, and I said, okay, we're just going to build a double coil. I built that, and it got the attention of the mainstream MR group. Then the thing, though, that, and the other thing you do is you don't poach other people. So Red Reddington, who was running the group, he was going to poach me. But on the strength of Bill's support, I asked for the job in that group. And that's what pulled me up. So my entrance into MRI was really on the strength of Bill's support of the work I had done. And I really didn't know a whole lot about MRI at the time. But as rummaging through, trying to find the material, I realized a couple things. I couldn't find too many pictures of Bill, as I said, and put the story together. I found that, the relationship that I had with him was in a number of key areas, incredibly supportive. But I found these old memo books, which is a nice inside look, if you wish, of what he was doing during this period of time. So one of the things that the group did, and Paul or Chuck could comment on who initiated this, but there are these memo books, and they're 2 inches thick. Notice Bill is on each one of these things, the guy leading the effort of putting it together. Then when you go inside, you realize why. Because Bill's the guy on most of the memos too. And this is a pretty impressive combination. What I've done in this particular case, in 1985, I've taken out, those items where Bill wasn't involved. But you can see the entire range of activities, from magnet design, gradient winding design, RF coils, preamplifiers, RF transceiver, some going on, imaging work, surface coil work, and now here we have this oil core imaging items, and I'll mention the oil core a little bit more in a second. So here's some comments on 1985. It's incredibly prolific. He's involved in all of these different activities. He embraced the idea of the Shielded Gradients, so that was a key supporter. It's what got me into the MRI group. And then he had a very, very keen interest in developing non-medical applications. He really wanted to see this little satellite company GE had, or division called GE NMR Instruments, that was doing analytical vertical bore systems and chemical sift imaging systems, as they called it, horizontal bore, for animal research. And he really wanted to see that business a success. And so he saw the new application, the technology of the shielded gradient coils is critical for that, and new applications, hence the oil core imaging and the connection to the gradient. So there was a strong collaboration with Al Johnson and Duke. It was really driven by Red, but supported by Bill and ultimately myself, and created this whole range. And Bill just drove that. He just said, we've got to make these different gradient coils. I didn't know what the real applications were, but I knew how to design the coils. And ultimately, the impact is tremendous, is Paul's point. People don't realize that this work ended up, things like, Mike Mosley, I'm just mentioning, he had got one of the Omega systems and was able to, suddenly the fusion started working. The collaboration with Shell Development, the gradient enhanced spectroscopy that started working, and I talked to Ralph Hurd about that. Now, it was unfortunate that GE decided not be in this business, but were it not for this work, I don't think it would have been a sale. It would have been a shutdown. 86, effort continues. By then, we're working, the surface coils. I mean, Cigna GE had branded its product. There was work now going on a low field system. He worked with the Yokogawa Medical Systems. Continued RF power amplifier. Here's a picture of Bill and myself getting an award, the Dishman Award at the GRD Center for the work on shielded gradients. Although Bill wasn't one of the original inventors, but if it wasn't for him, it wouldn't have been brought into product and pushed into that. And now here the oil core imaging. Here's a picture of an oil of a rock photograph and a picture. And again, you can begin to see the effort, and you can see the relationship with both myself and sort of supporting the technology, and with Harold Vinegar, even sucking in Chris Hardy here in some of this stuff, as you can see in the right bottom. Bill had the whimsical side too, and you know you can see that. And I pulled this particular picture. I managed to take some old 35 millimeter slides. That's the way we presented at the time, and was able to scan it. And so here you go. You know, he's making the case to the business of what to do. That you know, get oil core as a clinical, as an application that'll drive analytical systems. And here he is, also rock star in his fuzziest people. 1987. We've 4T. Interesting. Paul's comment about spectroscopy. I think immediately following the work at 1.5, I ordered the 4T. Part of that was on the spectroscopy. That was part of the reason for the interest in the shielded gradients too, was to make sure that the spectroscopy could be done. It was a very short moment in time. I mean, Bill and I, got the magnet. There was a little bit of competitiveness going on within the group that you can imagine. Sway Red set it up. We go ahead and get some images. Said, okay, done that. Not very interesting anymore. And I think that was the end of our 4T work at that point. But you could see the work continued in the arc body coils, and now the gradient coils. Look at this. We're building God knows how many different gradient coils here for G NMR instruments, the S180, we became the AccuStar gradients. Continued work in the RF receiver, there was the 0.5T system, and it just went on. My entrance into Bill's resume was item number 54 on the meeting abstracts when we presented. So Bill also got me involved in the society. And it was, at this conference here was my first introduction with Bill on the shielded gradients. I highlighted some red ones where he took the lead on various projects, but if you go through his resume, so I exist between item number 54. Here's oil core imaging work that he was doing, the phased array work that we started together based on some of his intrinsic signal to noise, and then finally at item 90, I'm sort of exiting in 1994. Back to this picture, you can see how these things now tie together a little bit, and there's the picture of Harold Vinegar and me looking at Bill saying, why are you taking another picture? These are just a couple photographs. You mentioned Red Reddington. There's Bill with Red. He's the person who hired Bill. He created an environment for the work to flourish. As you said, Bill and Paul, had an interesting relationship with management. Maybe it's okay for me to mention Bill. Bill mentioned a couple times on his to me over the years, and I think it was a badge of honor that on his EMS, his performance appraisal, Red had told him that Bill is persistent to the point where it's no longer a virtue. So, but I actually think he sees it as a compliment, and I think that rather people misunderstood him, and you can see where Bill had incredible patience. Maybe he didn't have, and where his patience ended when people didn't want to really know the truth in terms of understand the technology, understand what mattered. Bill here, as I said, also has a nice, sense of humor. Here I am in my leaving GE. He's given me a toilet flush valve. I'm actually sure I remember the details of that, but you imagine it had something to do with me leaving GE. And then
your regular picture days at work, so I pulled this one out. What I'd like to do is leave you with a thought about Bill and tie it back to those 12 students that over the years. I had a chance to chat with Fiona last week, and Fiona said she went to meet Bill at lunch, and Bill was having lunch with the graduate students, and apparently he did this on a regular basis. And as they're leaving, she said, "Well, that's really nice," or something to that effect, that you sit down with the graduate students, and do the other professors do that? And he said, "I guess not." And, you know, I would be on Bill's graduate student list if I didn't already have a degree, because Bill did for me and was doing for others what he just did naturally for those students, and I will always remember that.
Cincinnati Children.
Well, as you can imagine, this is can be a difficult talk, or is a difficult talk to give. It's difficult on many planes. One is following such excellent descriptions of what Bill's life was like and what he accomplished during his time. I had to sit down and while the previous talks were going on and pulling slides, I didn't want to duplicate. But fortunately, the easy part is that there's still a lot of material that has not yet been covered. And so I hope in the few minutes that I have here, they'll give you a slightly different perspective about Bill, perhaps one a little bit more personal, but also with the eyes of the people that worked with him. It's also a strange talk in that many of the slides you're about to see were actually presented at Bill's retirement party. So Bill and Fiona have actually sat down and seen these slides and have looked at them with us and enjoyed them with us. Some of these slides, I want to give you a photo of where it all started. Bill was born in Gloversville, New York. I think this is the town of Gloversville is named after an ancestor of Gary Glover, a bit of trivia there. But Gloversville, New York is very close to Schenectady. Just a coincidence, during the early part of his life, Bill's family moved around. They did end up in Schenectady for a little while, where his sister was born. But ultimately, they moved to Illinois, where he went to high school and then ultimately college. Here's Bill and his grade school class. Can anybody pick him out? Mm-hmm. Maybe this will help. Okay. Bill went to high school in Illinois and did quite well, went on to graduate school, and we all also already heard about his time in Scotland. So I'm going to skip down those aspects or incidents in his life and start right away with Bill coming to GE. So in the early days, the lab looked a little bit like this. You see Bill and Paul and John Skang. And there was a lot of activity in the early days, as Paul just described. And Bill did end up at in the top of his class. And so there you see him in the top of his class. But it was a pretty distinguished class. He had some guys who made well for themselves. Others had other successes. And some people have learned wonderful things to do with beer. And actually, it is true that beer does make a wonderful contrast agent if you're looking at the platter. Is that right, Paul? All right. Well, of course, Bill and his colleagues were responsible for many innovations in MRI, including, of course, the birdcage coil. We've heard about that. The phased array with Pete. Just general surface coils and doing all those sorts of little details. Oil Corps. We heard a little bit about that, but he was also very much involved in making images of ice and sea ice, sort of a spin out of his Oil Corps work. He also, of course, as you heard earlier, worked on the fundamental limits of signal-to-noise ratio and trying to understand what is the intrinsic properties that define SNR and an MR coil. One of the things that he is not quite well known for is, but I think is also very important, is the contributions he made to the low-noise preamp. He and Otwin Muller in the early days of MR created a preamplifier at the front end of the system that had a noise figure down around 0.3, 0.25 or so, which was markedly lower than the other preamps of the day, and that made its way into the product. And also, of course, in the 1986 meeting, presented an abstract that was entitled The Mystery of Q and the role that Q plays in coils and so on. We heard a little bit about the early field board days. Leon Kaufman pushed very, very hard that 0.37 was the optimum field, and of course Bill pushed back very gently, saying, well, 1.5 is a pretty good field. And then you saw this quote earlier, if you can't have a field you love, then love the field you have. So it was, as Paul pointed out, it was just a matter of letting the data speak for itself. Well, here's a photograph of the early 1.5T system. This is the 1.5T magnet that really launched the entire high field, or what was then the high field. It was a not a particularly good magnet. One of the problems was that it was really ordered as a 2-tesla magnet. It never did make 2-tesla. It ended up sending a lot of helium into the atmosphere with multiple quenches. And so basically they decided to park the scanner at 1.5T, and 1.5T became the standard because the images were so good. Now, had Oxford used the six sigma techniques that GE later employed, it's clear that the standard would be about 0.37. So Bill was involved in a lot of things, not just MR. One of the things that he did work on was PCB remediation using RF heating on the ground. This is a photograph showing the attempt to put electrodes down into the ground and to heat the ground to pull out contaminants like PCBs. Because at that point, GE was had very, very strong liability with lots of PCBs that were in the ground that had to be removed, and the EPA wanted something done about it. And Bell pushed real hard for the concept of in situ removal of these pollutants. But in reality, with an RF approach, the heat was so hard to control that you basically had very cold spots, very hot spots, and basically found a great way of making glass. But all kidding aside, once everything was worked out, they were able to take their technology up to Glens Falls and do some test burns on the in various areas of town, and created a large expanse of sand. But you notice here that the technique that was ended up being successful wasn't RF electrodes, but in fact large blankets that were laid or could be laid on the ground. And this large blanket, you heated up, had a gas recovery system. You could, in fact, very effectively remove PCBs from the ground. And Bill even pointed out that this could be even done at the in the bed of a river, where the Hudson River, there was a large amount of the PCBs. Ultimately, though, the EPA prevailed on GE and caused them to be GE to dredge up all this PCB contaminated soil. And I think they shipped it to Ohio. Bill was also very much involved in a variety of other things, including trying to make some scanners quieter. Here's an example of a very ugly scanner that that he built. And also, Bill was involved in one of the early experiments in MR incompatibility. And among his first is that he was around for the point. One of the things that I do want to relate to you is a story about the whiteout incident. The whiteout incident is It's a standard, well, not a standard, it's a well-known in the MR group we were in. And that is basically the safety officer at the R&D Center decided that a material data safety sheet, a safety data sheet, had to be associated with everything on site, and even the secretaries who use Whiteout had to have a binder with their MSDS about the Whiteout. And basically, Bill suggested that this was, in his kind and reasonable way, that this was perhaps a bit over the top. And so what happened was that there was probably one of the last battles that that he took on, and I think that it helped with the next phase of his life, and that was early retirement. So when early retirement came, Bill leapt to the opportunity and went on to work and seek a life after GE, and something very important for all of us who have worked in GE to realize that there is a life after GE, after all. One of the biggest companies in the world is not GE, but actually ex-GE. he went off and he formed a consulting group called MR Science. Notice that there's no N, which I found curious. And then eventually he went to Johns Hopkins, and Paul has told you some of the things he did while he was at Johns Hopkins, but some of the other things that Paul did not tell you about was that Bill was a very passionate in trying to establish voting technologies that would be fair and verifiable. This passion came from the U.S. presidential election in 2000. But Bill was very active in the state of New York, getting them to adapt to and choose the next generation of voting technologies, and really strongly advocated that they not go with electronic computer type screens simply because of the inherent problems, and stick with basically paper ballots that could be scanned. So he was very, very instrumental with that, and he actually served as a voting observer in some of the elections while he was in Baltimore. Another thing that Bill was involved in was this one of his last papers, and this is a paper which I think most scientists would love to have written, and probably primarily because he got to do it with his son. But it was a wonderfully insightful paper that that really pointed out that somebody who's traveling through interstellar space, interstellar space is not really a vacuum. There are random hydrogen atoms that are out there, and if you're traveling at a great velocity through space, you're going to be hitting these atoms pretty hard. And these atoms are going to appear as if they are radiation to you. Very high energy cosmic rays. And doing some simple math, they were able to show that, in fact, even if you went even sort of like half the speed of light, you'd probably get very quick, short order, a fatal dose of radiation. So the backlash in the Star Trek community was intense. The Star Trek community insisted that he knew nothing about warp cores and things like that, and dilithium crystals, which is kind of ironic for the inventor of the of spin warp energy. But still, he did enjoy the notoriety that got. And so I think it's fair that we propose, perhaps, or offering to this audience the definition of Edelstein radiation as the interaction of a large body, rapidly moving body, that interaction with a large number of small, relatively stationary bodies. And quite often, this sort of radiation can be damaging to the large body. But I think it really is a nice metaphor for Bill's life. Because in reality, what Bill did was he was a large, rapidly moving intellect. That had many collisions with small, relatively stationary intellects, and then he had a big impact on all of us. So here's a quick snapshot of his technical side of his career. Very, very productive. Huge number of citations, but more importantly, tremendous impact on the technology of MR, making so many fundamental contributions that today we just take for granted. So here's a photo of Bill toward the end of his life. This is the Bill we remember, and standing in front of a magnet. But in reality, he was also a very intense family man and a passionate liver of life. And so here he is visiting the old magnet that he's, where he started, and then here he is with his grandchildren in November of 2013. Well, so there you have it. In the last hour or so, we've seen a lot of details about Bill's life. Bill is no longer here, but the legacy of his contribution to our lives, to lives of anybody who do MR, and people who vote in New York and so on, his legacy is still there. So every time you use a phase encoding gradient or a birdcage coil, or perform spin warp imaging, anytime you do any sort of MR, you've got a bit of Bill with you there. So, thank you very much.